Okay, this is the Okapi with Epic Orchestra. Okay, so I'll walk you through kind of what's going on here. The setup is basically we've got the Epic Orchestra patches. First patch we have at the top are the Synchron FX strings, going through a couple different articulations. We've got three Wagner tubas. If you don't know what a Wagner tuba is, it's basically a hybrid between a French horn and a trombone. It's not a commonly used instrument, but it sounds neat. I've got a couple of things aptly named Weird Synth. Those started with presets from the Smart Spheres portion of the Epic Orchestra, but they have lots of edits to them. I'll get into those later. Eight horns, a woodwinds patch of staccatos and sustains, a drum set that was recorded as part of the Power Drums, I guess it's a Tama Star brand. Then we've got just a regular concert snare drum. Next we have the synchronized Epic Orchestra Appassionata strings with a few different articulations. A thing called Synth Pulse, which again was probably highly edited by me after using an initial preset. A percussion, which is just sort of an assortment of concert percussion instruments. Six unison trumpets, two different articulations. An oboe. A solo cornet, a patch I made called Sooth, which I'll get into that later. It's very strange, but it kind of works, because as you'll notice, I've got that on the same MIDI channel as these single hit timpani patches. And we will look into how those things go together to make sort of a unique pulse that is organic and synthy all at the same time. I'll start out with the FX strings soloed. So what we get at the top are these vertical tremolos, slowly increasing in volume and intensity. To a cluster gliss. And you will definitely have noticed that there is a bunch of delay on the main deca tree. That is to create sort of this odd pulsing sound. Like a machine. Like a strange machine that is cycling over and over and over and grinding itself out. And then you'll notice in this 6-4 bar here, as it kind of wraps up, I have this long high note, sort of give it a line to the end of the phrase, which is what is happening in the other instruments as well. Right here we get into the comedic music with the woodwinds and strings, and so I wanted a line to kind of bring us into that instead of just making it this repeated pulse thing. And then of course there's this stutter thing you'll see in the automation. Here I'm using just the expression, and I just drew this. And then I copied that down to other synthesizers, such as this thing labeled Weird Synth. Now this one is sort of like the scary monster of the synths. It's got this massive reverb on it. It's a plate reverb, pretty long decay, very wet. And that's on top of other reverbs. So you'll sort of hear. How this sort of brings us into a new universe, or new space, a new feeling. You know, at the top of this piece, we don't know exactly what's going to happen. This is a scary thing. Oh my goodness, what's gonna happen? You've got this 12-tone pattern in the Wagner tubas. It sounds like the monster is going to come out. And then we realize it's the Okapi. Let's cover the synth pulse here. The notes are arbitrary, I'm just trying to get noise. Help reinforce that stutter. Next part, 8 horns come in right at the end of that. Sort of continue the line of the Wagner tubas, sort of the vibe at least. I don't know. I kind of imagine this whole track sort of being like a cartoon. I have in my mind a cartoon where you sort of see the huge shadow of a monster coming around the corner, and then it's like a little mouse or something that was scaring everybody, but the shadow was so big because of the light perspective. I kind of had that in my mind as I was writing this. This sequence of notes in the Wagner tubas is just a 12-tone sequence. There's no particular reason why I chose that tone row. To be honest, it could have been any tone row as long as it sort of sounded atonal. Doesn't matter, to me at least. It is punctuated by those 6 trumpets. Sounds pretty good. And those velocities, I wanted them blaring, so everything's at 127. And you'll notice the key switches down here. Just for that, so it sounded more realistic. Next, this obnoxious drum set thing here. Like, like a punk band rhythm or something. But really, the whole vibe of this opening is really determined by not just the crazy rhythm and this sort of thing and nasty sounding, blatting Wagner tubas, but it's this big reverb thing that comes in. Oh, one other thing. That gong and those string effects is always a winning combination. Just a real good matching of timbres there. That sounding noisy, like you can still, like it just doesn't get totally washed out. It feels like timbrally, it matches very well. On into the tune. I think it's funny. So on the patches like the woodwinds in the Epic Orchestra, basically up and down the keyboard, you've got the woodwinds laid out in a way that you can play the parts like a piano. And I'm a pianist by trade. And so it makes it real easily to have instant orchestration that sounds good. Very easy to come up with something like that. If you have a tune on a piano, it translates very, very easy to the Epic Orchestra. You can probably just slide the MIDI over if it's something like this, as long as you have the correct articulation picked. And speaking of that, that's essentially what I did with the string parts. Is I just flew down the MIDI. Notice that that's not necessarily very well played in time. That's intentional. Obviously, I could tighten that up, and obviously, I could play it much cleaner. But this is sort of a comedic piece, and I wanted the illusion of sort of like a amateur set of musicians kind of tooling around in their, I don't know, community orchestra or something like that. Small town community orchestra or something. And so that's why I have in there this percussion stuff that's almost like it's some kids playing it or something. an out of place tambourine that's kind of silly. It's all supposed to be comedic. And I don't think playing things perfectly is necessarily funny. You don't get legatos with the Epic Orchestra on the appassionata strings, at least. However, those sustains on a passage like that, I think, is pretty convincing, and it can feel connected if you have the right overlap of the notes with the right feel. you know, I've turned the release up a little bit just to have a little bit more bleed from note to note. The Passanati strings are made off of a library that consists of like 20 first violins, 20 second violins. I mean, like real, real big sections of strings. And so they're, it's not going to be the most cleanly articulated ensemble anyway. And so I have decided in this particular case to double down with that aesthetic reality of a large ensemble, that there is going to be a little bit more smearing of the texture. And to do that, of course, you turn up the release a little bit. Now let's talk about this swoosh and the timpani. Now it's on the same MIDI channel, like I said. What is that? Okay, well, I'll tell you. So the timpani is just as it is. It's just a straight. I mean, that's it's very, it's like a clearly a close mic. But you'll notice I've got a runtime delay in there of 160. That's because it's working in conjunction, and you'll see that it's you know, way ahead of the beat by, you know, what is that, a 16th almost? More than a 16th. But that's because of this synth I kind of created. So it started with a preset, this Canon preset. And I put some extra effects on it. So if you listen to the sound by itself, sort of like this pulsing thing to the beat, auto gain is sort of like how EDM producers use sidechain compression to get a pulsing feel. You get, you know, I picked a shape, a rate, spread, it's synced to a quarter note. An amount has been dialed in. So you have that on this sound, which is sort of a tuba voice hybrid mix that, you know, the sound designers of the Smart Spheres came up with themselves. And then this thing is, so now you're getting the vibe that it's, what I've done is I've sort of, how do I explain this? I wanted to create an effect where the timpani is like triggering the side chain of this instrument. And to do that, I put auto gain on these things. So the combined effect makes it sound like the timpani is triggering a side chain compression. And it's sort of like it has like a little ramp up. Now that goes pretty well with the other instruments, because now it sounds like I've added tubas and things, but they're sort of otherworldly tubas. You can hear the articulation of the timpani, but there's sort of this after effect from that hit that gives it sort of this lumbering side-to-side pulse. Okay, next I want to talk about the cornet solo here. First off, I added a little bit of attack to these staccato articulations at the very beginning. And the reason I wanted to put a little bit of attack on there is because I wanted the articulation on the staccato to be a little bit more O and not E in its characteristic. One, so it a little bit closely matches the legato there, which is sort of a, which is a slur, I mean, is what it sounds like to me. A slur, and sometimes you can hear as if there's like a little bit of tongue in there articulating, just bumping the air just a little bit, which is how a real trumpet player on a, or a real cornet player, trumpet player, whatever, would be would try to perform it. The thing about the cornet that's different from the trumpet is that the cornet has a canonical bore like a French horn. What that means is from the mouthpiece all the way to the end of the bell, the bore of the instrument is getting larger, slowly getting larger, tapering out. And what that does is it gives it a much more open tone, and that lends itself very well to solo passages, especially ones that are more lyrical in nature. Trumpet players themselves even try to achieve that more open and lyrical tone that is more easily rendered on a cornet. And so in the spirit of that, I've tried to take the attack off the front of the articulation a little bit, not so it's just not so strictly articulated in staccato, but a little more lifting and bouncy. And that sort of bounce is better achieved if the tongue isn't totally stopping the air every short note. One thing that I also think gets overlooked sometimes in orchestral mock-ups are the ends of the notes. Everybody's often very focused on the legato transitions note to note or the beginning of the note. But it's the end of the note. I still want that note to have a very, very natural tail to it. And it needs that because there's not a whole lot going on afterwards. You have the oboes that are still kind of doing this rhythmic thing, the string pizzicato. And so he's really kind of alone there. And so you want it to be very, very natural. How a normal player would want to treat the end of his solo. Hear how natural that is at the very end. And then after the cornet solo, it wraps up, and I like sort of this open hi-hat from a drum set that plays the last note. Just sounds like everything is silly and broken. So that's it. That's the Okapi. Thank you for watching.